Welcome to the Yale Centre for British Arts online series, At Home, Artists in Conversation. I'm Christine Checinska, the Senior Curator of African and Diaspora Fashion and Textiles at the V&A, the Victoria and Albert Museum here in London. And I'm delighted to be here in conversation with Katharine Hamnett for today's programme. But before we start, I have a few housekeeping notes just to share with you. Please note that this programme will be recorded, your camera and sound are muted, and it will remain so throughout the programme. We'll be using the Q&A feature located on your navigation bar to gather your questions for Katharine, and these will be answered at the end, towards the end of the programme. But please feel free to submit any questions, comments in the chat, in the Q&A box as we go along. Yale University acknowledges that Indigenous peoples and nations, including Mohican, Mashantucket Pequot, Eastern Pequot, Shattuck, Golden Hill, Porkazit, Nyantak, and Quinnipiac, and other Algonquian-speaking peoples, have stewarded through generations the lands and waterways of what is now the state of Connecticut. We honour and respect the enduring relationship that exists between these peoples and nations on this land. Now for Katharine Hamnett, which is of course why you're all here. So Katharine, born in 1947, is an English fashion designer, best known for her slogan t-shirts, which I'm happy to be modelling for you today, as well as her outspoken advocacy for sustainable and ethical business practices. She's a graduate of Central St. Martin's School of Art and launched her own Katharine Hamnett label in 1979. In 1989, she was the first person to blow the whistle on the malpractices of the textile and fashion industries. And she's always lobbied directly on issues such as pesticides, the plight of cotton farmers, and she pressurizes her licensees at that time to reduce the impact of her collections, eventually shuttering production and turning her efforts solely to political activism. In 1983, Hamnett released the first of her now iconic oversized t-shirts, emblazoned with large block letter slogans. You'll see in a moment, George Michael of the English pop duo Wham wore her Choose Life t-shirts on a music video. And other fans of her label at the time included musicians like Boy George, Madonna, Mick Jagger. In 1984, Hamnett received the first British Fashion Council's British Fashion Designer of the Year Award. In 2011, she was appointed Commander of the Order of the British Empire for her services to the industry. And we'll come on to be in a moment to speak about her Buddhist philosophy that influences her work and was a real sort of game changer in her life and thinking at that time. But what's really interesting and really important is that even decades later, many of these slogan t-shirts remain strikingly resonant and relevant. She relaunched the label in 2017, and many of her classic t-shirts have been reissued, but they're so before their time in terms of thinking. And I think it's quite troubling, the fact that they are still so resonant now. But I want to kind of bring Katharine in now. So welcome, Katharine. It's great to be speaking with you today, and also great to be thinking about some of these important issues. And it's wonderful for me to be actually dressed in one of the issues today now. But maybe as we begin, why don't we go back to that Buddhist philosophy, that moment, that turning point in your life and in your career, and your thinking about fashion and bringing politics together with that.
Well, hi everybody. I've heard of being an eminence grise, but this is taking it a bit far.
So we're looking at the Choose Life shot, and we just want to maybe begin.
Okay, Buddhist philosophy. Well, I suppose in the 80s, I set up business in 79. We got very successful very quickly, but I've always been, I thought the key is, it's easy to be successful in business if you're a bad person, but the challenge is to try to be a decent human being. And I'd always been interested in the Buddhist philosophy, which talks about to be a good person, you have to live a kind of eightfold path, which means kind of right thought, right action, right speech, right effort, and right livelihood. And we were on such a roll in the fashion industry. We were doing so well. We weren't just selling political T-shirts. We actually sold those to soap because I thought we were getting so much publicity that more than we actually needed to sell our clothes, that it would be, and we were getting hugely copied, that it would be great to do something that people copied that made me laugh. Because if people copy your stuff and you know, you're selling it in the shops, it takes the bread out of your mouth. So I thought what would be great would be political, environmental slogans written on T-shirts, you know, that you can read from, you know, 200 yards. And the great thing about it, writing on somebody's chest, a T-shirt, you can't not read it. So anyway, I was at an exhibition. A friend of mine was doing Buddhism, on Buddhism, and it was a bit sad. And we had an argument about it because I really wanted to help and she wouldn't listen. And I said, we've got to do these T-shirts that say choose life, which is central to the Buddhist philosophy. And so I didn't just do that. I did, you know, a whole load of others. But the right livelihood thing is super interesting because I thought we were, you know, we were doing nothing. We couldn't possibly be doing any harm just making silly frocks. So I commissioned research. And to my horror, I found that I was up to my neck in a living nightmare. And so the T-shirts were, you know, obviously part of that. But I found that the clothing industry is responsible for total devastation across the planet, 12.5% of world agriculture, 25% of world pesticides. Pesticides kill everything, slave labor, every possible material that, you know, new clothing is made out of, even if you touch what you're wearing, has a horrendous impact on the planet. So I was suddenly thinking I was doing nothing wrong. I found myself as far away from right livelihood as it was possible to be. And, you know, having done really well out of the industry, I decided, well, I've got to put something back. I've got to try and fix this. And so I've been campaigning for the last, oh, I don't know, I've lost count, 30 years trying to get the clothing industry and the rest of, you know, all other industries, energy industries, to change, because we're right in the middle of it now. I mean, this is it. I mean, I'm sitting here in New Yorker in an unbelievable heat wave that is, you know, blazing across Europe. This is climate change. This is time to fix it now. That's sorry, I probably didn't answer your question very well.
Don't worry, because you're absolutely right. Because if we look back at what your thinking was then, and I was looking at some stats as well, and it is a time now where we have to recognise what we're all part of what's happening. You know, climate change is real. We have the IPCC discussions earlier in the week where finally people are actually saying, do you know what, guys, it's not a probability, it's here. You know, we've got the flooding, we've got the burning of Europe.
How we consume decides the future of the planet. 100%. And, you know, this is how we consume. This is what's happened. We're consuming wrong.
Yeah, because I was looking at some stats earlier this week and thinking about the fashion industry, and it's apparently just 1% of clothing that's recycled. So you have that on the one hand, but you also have, I found some figures, it said something like, that's right, so it takes 8,000 litres of water to manufacture one pair of jeans. I mean,
I'm not sure about those figures. They've kind of, they're sort of very hard to prove, you know, how much, you know, water was the cotton plant get. But yeah, I mean, the whole washing process on jeans is like hugely wasteful of water. And you would say, as an environmentalist, you know, the whole point about a product is that it should be durable, it should be last, and it should last as long as possible. And so by, you know, washing it, you're taking some of its longevity away. So that's a bad thing. So if you took that away, how much water would it take? You know, it takes water to dye. The biggest impact of any product is usually in its aftercare. You know, what kind of washing machine, what products you use in your washing machine? Do you use chlorine bleach?
Sure.
You know, things like that. You know, how much water do you use? How often do you wash your clothes? I mean, I'm no advocate of dirty clothing. I mean, I know that at one point in the environmental movement, people were saying you shouldn't wash. No, I'm sorry, disgusting. You've just got to find a way to wash. You know, cleanliness is next godliness. Terribly sorry. You've got to find a way to wash using less water and still coming out immaculate. You know, challenge is good for you. But anyway, back to what you're saying. Education, not missiles.
Education, not missiles. Which is, someone in the Q&A was asking what my T-shirt was saying, and it is the Education Not Missiles T-shirt that you can see on the PowerPoint slides, and I'm also wearing. And it's being reissued by Yale, actually. So Katharine, tell us about the origins of the Education.
Yeah, you can buy it, but where can they buy it from?
So we can buy it from the Yale Museum shop, and we can buy it from online as well, from your store.
Okay.
Because it is a reissued T-shirt.
Yeah, it is, especially for you guys. And I think it's a really important subject for America, because for a long time I've been seeing things flashing up that America spends 8 times what it spends on education, on defence. And then you get Trump. I'm sorry, guys, you know. But $1 invested in education apparently yields $8.6 in social benefits. I mean, there's not a business model that will yield you 860% return on investment. You know, I mean, this is what education is, the source of all wealth. Yes. You know, we're over plundering our natural resources. Now we've got to live with what we've got, even use our brains. Our biggest resources are imagination and our educated, you know, Library of Alexandria that's going on inside of our heads, you know, and our skills. And if we invest in that, we can get out of this shit. But if we don't, we've had it.
Absolutely.
It's a complete waste of money. I mean, any American, I'm sorry, I shouldn't be telling anybody else what to do. But, you know, the policy of endless, you know, long, slow war, what benefit has actually given the American public? You know, and what has been destroyed? And but what benefit to anybody? I mean, the war is the biggest environmental disaster of all. We should just be, you know, looking at our world right now and saying it's on fire. You know, stop fighting. We've got to put it back. Otherwise, rich and poor, we're all dead.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And we take everything else with us as well. This kind of unbelievable miracle that we've been given.
Absolutely. And it's definitely the time that, I mean, we literally...
So exactly. Your next slide.
We have to do it. And I think that's what's so remarkable, again, because this is a reissue, isn't it? But it just speaks volumes about where we are now. You know, one of the things, though, Katharine, I think that many people, many of us, feel perhaps helpless in terms of wanting to move forward, wanting to make a change, wanting to perhaps consume in a different way, wanting to act in a different way that's more in harmony with the planet and with people, rather than, you know, having a destructive, maybe overly individualistic, not looking to the future way. But what would your advice be for those of us that want to make a change?
Well, I think you've got to look at the big picture, is that basically government is owned by business. And yet the only money the government has is taxpayers, voters' money. The only money they've got to pay with is our money. Well, we've got a right to demand how it's spent and how it's not spent. And the only way, I mean, we did a T-shirt. Unfortunately, we haven't got a picture of protest and survive. Protests are getting quite dangerous, and I think we need to up our game. You know, not get shot. I'm sorry, forget about marching, but apply political pressure. And the only pressure that politicians respond to is something that threatens their ability to get re-elected. And so if everybody started getting onto their politicians, I mean, I'm not going to teach my grandmother to suck eggs. People like Stacey Abrahams, the job that they've done of grassroots activation in Georgia is just absolutely extraordinary. But if you threaten your elected representative that you won't vote for him next time unless he represents your views, and you'll be tracking how he votes, and you do it, this is the only way that we can see change. I think we have to reclaim our democracy, because democracy is supposed to be government by the people, for the people, and representing the majority, representing people's views, also tolerating a minority view. But we need to look at the Swiss direct democracy model, as something that we should devolve to, because our political system isn't fit for purpose. Mm. You know, we love Biden when he was elected, but he seems to be just melting into Republican. You know, is that what everybody really wanted? Mm. I don't think so. I think they wanted something much more radical. I felt the groundswell in America was, you know, okay, on the kind of intelligent left was AOC. But this is the only people that are actually proposing something that's going to deliver a future.
Yes, yes.
But unless we get politically involved, I think we've just spent the last 60 years after two horrendous world wars, you know, spoilt by our parents who never wanted us to go through the same shit they went through, rotted by comfort. But unless we take hold of our democracies now and get back in there, you know, it's like use it or lose it. We won't have democracies anymore. There's a huge right-wing drift, which is anti-democratic, and that's not good for anybody.
Absolutely, 100%.
Sorry, but end tirade.
No. One of the things I want to ask then is, because I'm with you on what you're saying around this, but how does that then dovetail into, on the one hand, your own business model and how you produce your clothes? I remember when we spoke before, we were talking about traceability and transparency, working in this responsible way that comes back to this idea of right livelihood. So that's one thing. How does that play? How does all of this weave together into your own business practice? But again, I still want to think about how do we, as everyday people, how can we act differently to make this change? You know, and it might be how
it's the first thing. It's like voting with your wallet, isn't it? It's, you know, how we consume decides the future of the planet. So you can't expect somebody else to tell you. You've got to read it up yourself. You know, you've really got to inform yourself. And with the internet just sitting there, you know, you can say, you know, bad effects of chlorine bleach, for instance, toxic household products, look it up. You know, things like drain cleaner. Oh, my God. You know, all of these things. But you can do it in the way that you shop and buy organic as much as you can. You know, all of those thousand, we've been all told what to do 1,000 times. We know what to do, recycle. But unless we have legislation, nothing's going to change. Because we can recycle as much as they like, and they're going to open, you know, more coal mines in Australia. You know, we've really got to get a grip. And, you know, because corporations who own government are actually owned by thousands of little shareholders. You know, there was a perfect case of Greenpeace who wanted to change a large fossil fuel company's behavior. So they bought enough shares to be able to show up at an annual general meeting of the fossil fuel company, demanded a motion that was supported by the shareholders that the fossil fuel company should clean it back. It was passed. The fossil fuel company cleaned up its acts. The shares went up. Greenpeace sold their shares and made a profit. It's these kind of things, but also divesting yourself of shares. America's a huge stock market players. Look at how well behaved is your best playing stock. Look at your stocks. Get rid of all the ones that are bad, that are having a negative impact. Do your homework. You know, at least you could do that.
Yes. I love this idea of doing your homework, because I think what I'm hearing is do your homework, do the research, be curious, delve deeply, question things, and then make a choice, an educated choice, which is kind of what you do through your business, actually. Because I remember you saying before that this idea of going to the factory and not just taking the first thing that people say to you around sustainable practice and, you know,
you have auditing. You have to have property. You know, there's a load of auditing organisations, reputable organisations now that will do it for you, but you have to have proper audits. And you should, ideally, even if you've got a factory in India which is being audited by an auditing company, you should have multi-stakeholder auditing. So you should also have, you know, be in conversation with local teachers, local doctors, local heads of community. So you can actually double check what's happening with your audit. Because there have been cases of corruption with audits. Because obviously, you know, somebody signs a corrupt audit and balefuls of stuff made by slave labor can, you know, charge off to Europe. So you have to be pretty stringent. But legislation is something that, when we were talking before, I thought it's the only thing that's actually going to make any difference. I mean, with the clothing industry, if we had in our economic blocks the legislation that only allowed goods in to our economic blocks that were made to the same human rights, labour, environmental standards as is mandatory inside, so that the standards actually, the goods coming from Cambodia or whatever, have to carry the same environmental standards and certifications as goods made in Europe, you see a huge change, because you'd clean up the environment, the greed, although the, you know, the factories, the manufacturers and the governments, you know, outsourced countries have to pay for it. You'd improve the plight of the workers, and you'd make your domestic manufacturing more competitive. So you'd clean up the world. You'd make a more equitable situation as far as pay. They were obviously going to be a bit cheaper than Europe or a bit cheaper than America, but at the same time, you'd have high standards everywhere. This would have an enormous global impact environmentally as well as socially, and it would even out, you know, the economies of Western countries as well as helping developing countries clean up their act. So I'm keen on that.
So sourcing locally, sourcing natural fibres in your collections?
Yeah, you've got to be careful of some so-called natural fibres. Things like bamboo is not an environmental fibre. It's actually quite a nasty viscose, which is made from bamboo pulp and is no better than any other kind of horror viscose. The only viscose, you know, so you have to be careful. There's things like the lensing process, viscose is okay. Organic cotton is good. Conventional cotton is bad. Wool is dodgy because there's so many nasty things used in the processing. Polyester, unless it's recycled, polyester should be completely avoided. Nylon should be completely avoided unless it's recycled. Hemp is good. You know, linen. Cashmere is a bit dodgy because of overgrazing. Could be contributing to desertification in Mongolia. And other places where the cashmere goat is farmed. So you're kind of got to be, I mean, it's heartbreaking because, I mean, I'm in love with textiles, you know, that's where I kind of came in.
Yes.
And so the cashmere and chartreuse, you just go, oh my God, this is so beautiful. Can't resist it. And you have to be careful not to bring, you know, I mean, you would say probably don't use it.
And so do you find now then that there are just a handful of suppliers of fabrics and a handful of factories that you have been able to scrutinize that you
feel there's a lot. I mean, it's come on hugely since 89. I mean, 89 went to a trade fair and we've been doing, you know, fantastic business. I had a fantastic jeans business. And I, you know, went on a stand with somebody who I bought hundreds of thousands or ordered hundreds of thousands of meters from and said, I'm looking for organic cotton. He wouldn't even let me on the stand. He sort of folded his arms, leant against the door and said, why should I get it? Because since you're the only person asking for it. And now there's thousands of mills that are making it. I mean, it's in short supply because I think there's suddenly been an uptake in kind of environmental understanding. And that it's actually in quite short supply at the moment, but the benefits that it gives the farmers are just completely immeasurable, allowing them to feed and clothe their families, you know, feed, clothe, shelter, educate their children, afford healthcare. It's not the case right now, but we need more of it, and it's moving too slowly.
Yeah. Just thinking about now, coming back to design, how do you, tell me about your process. How do you begin? Do you begin with the fabrics, or how do you, and I'm moving on to Oprah far too soon, but let's keep on Choose Love.
Hi, Oprah.
I think we're on to this idea of working in this harmonious way. So yes, let's choose love. And tell me about how that impacts your choices and how you begin your collections.
Okay, so I'll tell you the story of the Choose Love t-shirt. There's actually a friend of my son's who is this wonderful woman called Josie Norton. And she was actually a PA for Chris Martin, and she decided she needed to help the refugees. And so she left Chris Martin and set up this organization called Help Refugees. And they were soon just doing the most incredible work across Europe in the beginning of the refugee crisis, right the way from the Middle East through to Calais. And she came to see me one day, and they were absolutely desperate for money. And the friend of my son said, well, maybe Katharine design your T-shirt. And so we sat down, had a talk. And I thought, well, how about Choose Love? Because it's what it's about. And it's a beautiful message to see. I mean, it's something that we should apply to everything that we do. I think, you know, in a lot of religions, you know, the ultimate expression of the Godhead is love, you know. Even I think Jesus said God is love. But you can come full circle. I mean, I'm so complete agnostic. But I think it's something that I had written on the inside of my glasses because I need to be reminded to choose everything, to do everything that I do. Choosing the love path rather than the hate, murder, or chop everybody's bits and blow the place up, which is my natural tendency. So anyway, gave it to Josie. She made the most wonderful job of getting it out there. They got it on Oprah, which I can't believe, and loads of other amazing film stars, blah, 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 and sold loads of T-shirts and raised over $53 million. And I kept going up. And by the way, with COVID, they could somebody go on their site, Choose Love guys, and give them some money because they're in desperate straits. All the funding, all the charities has dropped off. Gosh, and these guys are putting money into babies' mouths the next morning, and they're working from Syria to the Mexican border. So they're doing a great job. And I think it was, of all the T-shirts that I've ever done, that's the one that's made me the happiest. I mean, I had that one that I wore to meet Margaret Thatcher, which was a kind of practical joke, which was quite funny.
Do share that story. I loved it when you were telling me about how that came about and your approach, because I think it says something about your form of activism as well. Because you were telling
I was just being naughty. I really was. My family were, you know, they sort of love a photograph of themselves next to somebody important, and they were quite right wing. And so I thought, I'll get one of those photographs of somebody next to somebody important that would really annoy them. Of course, they were so dazzled by her. My mother didn't realise that she'd hated it. So she thought, Thatcher thought it was marvellous. So that one backfired.
Oh my goodness.
But yeah, it was funny. And I didn't know that it was going to go quite as far as it did. And it's still kind of knocking around and popping up.
Yes.
But I mean, it was actually intended as a joke.
Fantastic. But before we move on, just so that people can find out more about the story behind the Choose Love T-shirt and the refugee charity, how can people find out more about that?
Just go on to Choose Love. It's their website.
Brilliant. So just go to the Choose Love website. Fantastic.
Yeah, choose it. And give them loads of money, please.
Fantastic. I can see that there are a few questions coming through in the Q&A. So I think I'm going to scroll forward. And then
it's such a shame. You can't see me, can you? You've got no visual.
I can see you. I can see everything. I'm kind of the all-seeing eye on this, in this conversation in some ways, because I can see everything.
I can't see you. I mean, I can't see myself.
Can you see the screen? Because we've got quite a few questions about the screen. So, for example, someone is asking about the photography. So, you know, you were saying...
Oh, yeah, photographer was Alex Sturrock. The ones of Kesh.
Yes, those are the ones. So you were explaining that Kesh, the model, was a friend of a friend.
Yeah, she's a friend. She was actually a best friend of my PA. She's now something super famous. I can't remember what, because I just think of her as Kesh. But the guy who took the photographs is a really talented photographer called Alex Sturrock.
Alex
Sturrock. I think it's R-O-C-K.
Brilliant. Thank you. And then we've got another one here, which I'm just going to read. Having been in the fashion industry for many years now, is there any important advice you might give an aspiring designer? Perhaps things you wish you knew when you were starting out?
If I'd known when I started out what I know now, I'd never have gone into the business.
Really? Why do you say that?
Because it's so hard to, it seems to trip over itself every step of the way. You know, from the inception of the idea, you know, from the manufacturing, we have to have clothes. We have to have clothes. It's like you need to feed yourself, shelter yourself, and clothe yourself. I think that those are like the top three. then, you know, kind of educate your families and afford healthcare. So maybe in the top five, very hard to know. I mean, you had to really study sustainable production systems. I'd have thought you really need to, unless you don't care. But, you know, I can't really advise you if you don't care. But if you do care, it's a pretty scary business. Why not be a filmmaker? Da, da, da.
Exactly.
Be a filmmaker.
Because I think if you're creative, you kind of have to just, it's a compulsion, isn't it? Would you say
that? I mean, the thing is, you know, if you're an artist, you can be an artist in many fields. I mean, if you're going to study fashion, you have to study history of art and history of fashion. And you have to get as close to that as you possibly can. You need to visit the museums, you need to touch, you need to feel, you need to see the real colours, you need to see the texture, you need to be able to recognise fibres by touch. You know, you learn how, you need to know how to pattern cut, you need to know how to do every single thing that you're going to tell something else to do when you're some big shot famous fashion designer. You need to know how to do it perfectly yourself. I don't know if I go as far as double entry bookkeeping, which is something I particularly hated, but languages are also useful. The biggest thing that helped me, apart from having had wonderful teachers at St Martin's in pattern cutting, history of art, photography, blah, 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 was being able to speak French. And so, you know, French is useful, Italian is useful. I like to speak Italian because I was getting lots of jobs in Italy. And so my Italian was pretty appalling, and I specialised in terrifying swear words.
That sounds pretty good.
I translated really bad English ones into things that would fold grown men in half.
Fantastic.
Yeah, if you're going to learn Italian, you have to think fishwife, if you're going to get anywhere.
Fantastic.
You
know,
it's like you have to go through an exorcist through the chauvinism. You know, and you probably need a chador. I'd recommend any young woman going to Italy should be veiled head to foot, because Italian men can actually be a pain in the ass.
Literally.
Well, they'd like to be, you know.
So, Katharine,
okay,
one of the other... we'll delete that bit.
No, don't. No, there's a few people I know. I don't need to hear that.
I'm joking. So what designers, these are other questions in the Q&A, what designers, if any, inspired you while you were growing up?
Oh God, I mean, designs. I mean, clothing's about role play. I was, you know, I was very lucky because my mother adored clothes, and so she'd take me to museums and I'd see beautiful, we lived in Paris, it's a beautiful kind of 18th century, 19th century, early 20th century. I mean, beautiful clothes. I mean, you can go back to Tudor, look at the workmanship, the crazy things they do with all the tiny, pretty parts. And then they do slashed fabric. I mean, they were completely mad. I love, you know, the 20th century, I love it all. I've got a beautiful brand yearbook from Vogue in 1936. Absolute dream. I love I love all of it because everything had its moment, 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s. I think because of my age, when I look at 90s, everybody says, oh, they really love my 90s stuff. I look at it, I hate it. But, you know, they like it. I just thought, oh, God, spare me. Jesus, did I do that?
Brilliant. I've got another.
Yeah, I mean, it's all to do with context, I think. I mean, right now I'm wearing a dress which is taken like from I think it was an original Viennet pattern.
Oh, wow.
Because I love, you know, Viennet. So beautiful. You know, I used to love Schiaparelli. I've gone off her a bit. And even like Chanel made a statement about, I mean, it's all about role models. I mean, I would say that fashion, clothing, this fancy dress, you've got these kind of cultural references. Even in the cut of a men's shirt collar, there's so much you can do. It's like coded messaging. There's a language in clothing that we all understand and we don't know that we speak.
One of the things that I've always loved about your collections, Katharine, and I'm thinking back to when I was at art school and so on, because I always felt that you had this wonderful, almost a marriage between something that's quite almost a utility feeling, but it was always very sensual. And I loved that coming together for me when I looked at those collections of, and it's interesting to me that you're talking about V&A, because I think that she has that kind of sensuality that I almost recognize in those flashback memories of some of your collections that I liked that had that sensuality about them. And even today when you were styling my t-shirt, I felt that I was getting increasingly more sensual and sexy with my t-shirt. So there is that element in your work.
I just like clothes that bring out the real you, you know, that's a bit. There's a French term which is hard to translate. They say mettre en valeur, which is to bring out the natural beauty of somebody. I think clothes can have, I'm a huge pragmatist. I've learned to look at my eyes, I've worked with the eyes of people that hate me because I had to run my own business. But I believe that like a beautiful object can have a sort of an anima. And I think for me, clothes, you know, good garment has an anima. It comes alive, you put it on, and it kind of fuses with who you are and brings you out. And it's an extraordinary process, and it's fascinating to see it happen. I think that's when clothes work, and that's the one thing that keeps me interested in clothes, because they have that extraordinary quality to meld with you. You become them, they become you, you become the you you want to be, the better you. I don't know, it's just completely digressing again. I love that anima thing in clothing. I mean, I was reading books recently talking about that, you know, atoms actually choose, you know, which way they're going to go. So if they have, there's a decision-making process in there somewhere. Like, what else is there? You know, that is quite extraordinary. So there's a life in matter. I think that's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah.
And there's a sort of character. There is a kind of magic in it.
I think so, because it's that sort of transformative element, isn't it? When you put something on.
Yeah, but you're playing with, it's all to do with role models, isn't it? To the archetypes and role models are wrong. You know, and what I meant is like the archetypal human characteristics or professions, or even kind of types of people. You know, you can wear jewelry like a duchess, can't you?
Yes. Just noticing again in the question and answers, I think people are really keen to hear more about your studio practice, so more about the process of designing. So I think that's interesting, this love of the way that clothing can speak and draw out the individual. But are you designing for specific individuals when you're designing? And tell us a bit more about your studio practice, the process itself.
Well, when I design, I think all designers design for themselves. Actually, men or women doing women's wear or men's wear. I mean, I've done both, you know, for a long time. And I design for the people I love. I think we've got to put something extra into it. It's like, if I'm making a suit for a man, I'm not a man. So it's what, it's my boyfriend, or it's my brother, or it's my best friend, or it's my gay friend, or it's my trans girlfriend who wants to wear a suit. But what I want is to put something in that garment that is really special. There's just to get it actually right, get it really perfect. Then you stand back and you think, is there anything else I can do to it? Just going to give it that twin. And sometimes it might be one button less. It might be something less rather than more. Sure. But I think it's going towards molding this creature that comes to life, like, you know, Frankenstein. The Frankenstein process, and then it works. But I think it's you doing it because you want them to look beautiful. They're going out on a date, they're going for a job interview, got to go and see their difficult blah blah. But it's armor, I think clothes are armor, you get it right and they protect you. So a huge amount of that, then a colossal amount of expertise. I am pernickety to beyond on fit. I had a fantastic pattern cutting teacher at St. Martin's, Christine Checinska, who also taught John Galliano, who was a wonderful pattern cutter. And she was absolutely marvelous because she knew all about it. She did a flat pattern cutting and we worked at speed. And I use flat pattern cutting, but also I know how to drape on the stand. Sure. So it's important. She'd been a certain, like a beautiful, something like Vionnet, she believed it. Well, in the end, it ended up as the most beautiful flat patterns as well. Mm. But you need to have all of these skills, and it's not enough being able to do it on the computer. I mean, I'm completely hopeless on the computer, but I've got an encyclopedic knowledge of the history of art and history of photography, which I mine the whole time for what I'm doing. I think the beginning of designing something, you would think, why do we need it? Why should what kind of new thing should exist? Mm. What is the point? You know, it's got to have a reason to be. Otherwise, it's just a waste of time. It's not going to work. And I think you have to have a very subjective relationship with it. I think it's not only designing for yourself, it's designing for something that you kill for.
Yeah.
And because if you won't kill for it, nobody else will. The customer is the same as you. We are one on that. Okay. Mm. You may, you know, somebody like me, I kind of upper middle class, left wing mindset, blah, blah. Lots of people dress like me, you know. And so if I want it, I think that we all think the same about clothes. You know, when we have that white shirt, we want to have that teensy weensy stitching. We want to have those delicious men's muslin flower buttons that are just super fine, the most beautiful color. We want that stuff. It makes us feel good.
Mm.
So, it's that kind of approach, but backed up with like technical color. I think my experience, the French do the best colors. The Italians and the Brits. The Brits tend to look like old school ties. In the end, they revert to that. The Italian, you give those marvelous colors in Italy, they bring them back to England and they suddenly look cheap. Sorry, Italians. But the French colors are so beautiful. They just do these shades. And it must be something to do with the light.
It must be.
Or to do with what Charles X invested in decorative arts from the last sort of 200-300 years or something. And they had the most amazing training in schools and industry and perfection. But yeah, go for French colours. And I think you need to know all of that stuff. You need to know how to mix your colours yourself. If you're looking for a particular blue, don't go around. I mean, don't do that thing where people go to Prada and buy a green coat because they like that green coat and then chop it up and give it to all their factories, a little piece each. Like, how wasteful is that? How pathetic is that? You need to be able to do all of that colour matching yourself. And then I think it's really good to do photography because if you are a designer and you think of something and there's sort of an anima in it, you've got to be able to think of how would you like, what would be the perfect place that it was seen? Learn how to photograph it yourself.
Mm.
You know, study photography. Look at Man Ray. Look at Blumenfeld. Look at Coffin. Look at, you know, all the great, you know, just study history of photography and work out, you know, look at Jürgen Teller. Look at Terry Richardson, who I gave his first job to, who blames me for everything. I think those are all part of the process. And what's lovely is it's hell's fun.
Oh, gosh, absolutely. It's like, I used to think it's like professional play in some cases. But one of
the... Yeah, I never thought it was a job. I just thought we were having a hysterical laugh.
One thing that I'd love to ask, though, as well, is so you've spoken to us about art, the history of fashion, photography, knowing about dyeing, knowing about cutting and draping. Has music had an influence on your practice in any way? I mean, do you listen to particular music when you're working? I know some people do that. Or how does music weave into
I suppose work? I like soul, you know, I listen to a lot of that music I always had. I've got a sort of natural preference for it. So, you know, Johnny Hooker, I don't know, Marvin Gaye. I'm not too, I mean, who do I like? Oh God, I'm missing this Kanye, what's his name? Da 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 da. It'll come back to me. God, senior moment on that. I don't listen to music enough, but I do listen to, yeah, blues, soul, flamenco, I love. I'm pretty eclectic. Love Mozart, Satie. I tend to read 19th century novels more than I would read 20th century novels. So possibly my musical taste is slightly further back in that. But we always used to have the most rip up tracks for our fashion shows, which I would work on intensely. It was quite funny. You could actually, if you play Rolling Stones when you've got girls, even if you haven't got girls going down the catwalk, people will clap. People are so swayed. Music is so powerful. Perfecting people's mindset or actual kind of concept of the reality that they're living in is wonderful. So, yeah, we used it mercilessly.
Wonderful. I've now got sort of John Lee Hooker and Jagger ringing in my ears now, you know, and maybe some Hendrix. How are you on Hendrix?
It's okay. I mean, I love Run DMC, you know, even NWA, because I had boys that just when they were coming out, and so I was brought up on hip hop.
Wonderful.
So I love hip hop, really.
Gosh. But do you know what, Katharine? I'm looking at my clock and I can see that we're almost out of time. Let me just see if there is any other. I feel like I could carry on listening to you speaking for hours, but let me just see.
Have we got anything from our audience? How many people have we actually got watching this?
Well, we had up to 73 a moment ago, but I'm not really looking at the numbers. It fluctuates, but let me see. Actually, this is a nice question. It's the last question to come in. What is next for you? What projects are you working on in the future? That's a lovely thing to maybe round up with.
Well, one of the things I'm doing is I'm thinking of writing a TV series based on my experiences in the fashion industry, which means that I might have to set it in Russia because so many people would be after my blood.
Oh, my goodness.
So there's that. Attempting to move to Mallorca, and so I'm very interested in cooperative models. Well, I'm not so. I'm just in the situation of being an agricultural community where a cooperative model would be an absolute gift of God. And so I want to set that up. I'm waiting to see what's happening with the fashion industry post-COVID, if it's going to exist, which way to jump, where I could be of value, where I could do something that people need. And want, but I don't know what that is right now. It's also scary, really, isn't it, out there? I just feel so worried about everybody. I want to do a book and a documentary. I want to do a book about my fashion career for fashion students, actually, giving them what I think I did right, what I did wrong, what I wish I'd done, how it worked, what you need to know, I think. You know, linking that as just as a help because we need clothes.
Absolutely.
You know, and at least if I could write down things not to do, what do they say? A wise man learns from his own mistakes and a very wise man learns from another's. So I could be the other and it would be there like, don't do this. Oh my God, you know, do that.
Fantastic. Oh, well, Katharine, thank you so much. It's just been such a delight chatting with you. And honestly, I could sit and listen to you speaking and for hours. And I feel like I want to make a difference myself, even in my small part of the fashion world. So I'm going to round up our conversation there and thank you so much. And on behalf of Yale, I just want to share that this is the end of this particular series of In Conversations until the fall. But do join Yale on September the 17th at 12 p.m. Eastern Time, where there'll be a conversation with artist Titus Kaffer. So we'll leave it there. And thank you so much, everyone. And thank you so much, Katharine.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.